¿Cómo están todos ustedes? Esto es ¿Qué onda? Yo soy Eduardo Fernández, transmitiendo desde Atlanta, Georgia, a todo el mundo. Esta mañana tengo a un buen amigo y abogado con especialización en contratos comerciales y derechos de la propiedad intelectual, Tom Talmadge.
Talmadge, you've got it.
I got it. Talmadge. Muy bien, muy bien. ¿Cómo estás, Tom?
Very well. Thanks for having me, Eddie. Gracias por invitarme.
No, muy contento de tenerte aquí. Creo que la información que... Lo que vamos a platicar, ¿verdad? Es pero de vital importancia para muchas personas. Sobre todo que nos escuchan músicos. Personas que tienen ideas. Que quieren proteger un proyecto. O que quieren proteger su negocio. O a lo mejor se pueden meter en problemas. Y usando ciertas cosas que le pertenecen a otra persona, a veces los logos, imágenes de otras personas. En fin, es un mundo de cosas que podemos platicar y que podamos aprender. ¿Entiendes español bien, verdad?
Sí, sí, sí. Yo hablo también, pero es más fácil para mí conversar en inglés para las topicales complejos, por ejemplo, la ley, cómo no.
Aquí, a lo mejor si mantienes... No hay problema, no hay problema. ¿Cuál es tu equipo favorito en el fútbol, soccer?
Fútbol, soccer, Atlanta.
Eso, Atlanta United.
Por los Estados Unidos.
Y los Estados Unidos. Todo el mundo. Y bueno, trae su camisa de México.
Ah, sí.
¿Por qué traes tu camisa de México,
Mi esposa es de México.
Eso, ¿de dónde es tu esposa?
De México.
¿De dónde es?
Es de Jalapa.
Ok.
En Veracruz, sí.
Jalapa, Veracruz.
Sí.
¿Cómo la conociste y por qué hablas español?
Aprendí en México, en un programa de inmersión en Oaxaca, pero okay. Hace muchos años.
Muchos años.
14, 15 años.
Muy bien. Sí. ¿Qué te gustó de México?
Mucho. Sí, me encanta México.
¿Qué más? Sí,
toda la cultura y cómo no la comida.
¿La comida?
Sí, sí, las bellas, todo.
La libertad, ¿no? Como que te sientes bien padre estar allá, bien como que libre. Ayer estaba escuchando... Tell me if you're not understanding this, because this is weird. Let me tell you. We were talking about music. You like music, right?
Love music, yeah.
Your favorite artist is Bruce Springsteen.
You asked me, and I said Bruce Springsteen. The part about that I like is that it's really hard for me to even define a favorite.
Yeah, me too.
I love music. I love the connection that it brings people. I love the places and memory that it brings you back to. I love the messages. I love the sounds. It's wonderful. So, and I love, old style rock and roll that I grew up on. I love, soft rock type yacht rock music from the 70s. I love Latin music. I've been lucky enough from my days in Mexico, cause I got to live there for 3-4 months and get a much better feel for it. I love reggae music. I love old blues music. I just like a lot of different things.
It's hard to pick a band. The other day, someone said, and what is your favorite band? And I said, well, I used to have a favorite when I was younger. I had Kiss was my favorite band. And then Aerosmith. No, then Queen. Then Aerosmith. Then Iron Maiden. And then I quit. I said, no more favorite bands. It's way too much.
Sometimes it depends on your mood or where you are in life, right? Which part? So one of the funny things that I've always said when people ask, and kind of what's your genre type thing, right? Because a lot of people just, they like techno or they like Latin or they like heavy stuff, and maybe just that one thing. My record collection, I'm dating myself talking about records a little bit, but when I was growing up, my album collection, right, which used to be the thing, it was so disparate. I had things as soft as Air Supply, right, and kind of singer-songwriter, Simon and Garfunkel, right?
Great music.
And I had stuff as heavy as, I loved Judas Priest, Motley Crue and Rat and all that kind of crazy heavy stuff and everything in between. So it's been a lot of fun.
You know what? It's funny, but I was so into Judas Priest. And I was about to be my favorite band when Iron Maiden show up. And then I went to see in Laredo, Texas, in Laredo Civic Center, I went to see Judas Priest opening Iron Maiden.
Yeah.
I was so lucky, my two favorite bands in that moment.
All in one night.
In one night. And then I happened to be that I got so early, and the guy know me, the guy that the one of the organizers saw me outside and asked me to help him with a few things. So he let me watch the sound check.
Oh, wow. So it's like bonus concerts.
oh my God, I couldn't believe concerts. These guys came out in jeans and, you know, like a shirt, t-shirts, and I couldn't recognize them. Back in the days, there was not internet or whatever. Just have a few images of them.
Recognize the sound, but
yeah,
not the,
yeah,
not
yeah.
The
no, but in the beginning, they were not. They just getting their guitars, and they say, "Oh my God, what? Who are they? They look like Iron Maiden. I can't believe." And then, oh my God!
So good.
Like, I was crazy. But anyway, great night. Yeah. Well, we were saying that. Well, let me show you this. This is crazy. Okay. Someone sent me this link yesterday, and I thought it was one of those stupid links that people is sending or someone is sending. Let's see. Guess what's that?
Run right with wings.
I wanted to tell you that supposedly be the Beatles of the other world, the parallel world. Because in the parallel world, they still there. They
gotcha.
Didn't die
gotcha.
And all that. And this guy went to a parallel world and stole a cassette and brought it here. And I was listening to it, and it's so weird that all the things. I mean, I never give too much time to that, but last night I went to bed listening, and I started getting scared. Do you watch Interstellar?
No.
Well, that's a good movie to watch, but you're going to say something.
I was just going to bring up whether this relates to there's a movie that's either been out or is about to come out about somebody who's the only one who either hears or relates to the Beatles, right? Their whole catalog of music, right? And nobody else knows them or, right? This is some sort of alternate universe where nobody else in the world knows or appreciates Beatles music, but except this one guy who, you know, has access to it all and appreciates it, and I'm sure is tortured by the fact that nobody else is getting it. Which
in
is
the other
funny.
World, in the parallel world.
Yeah.
It's so weird, and I was getting scared. Actually, I was in bed, and then I heard something. It's so unreal. Estábamos platicando que la música que puse ahorita es de un tape que alguien me mandó de un link de YouTube, donde se supone, actually, that album of the Beatles is called Everyday Chemistry. That's the name of the Beatles. They're playing, still playing together in that world, and nothing happened. And they're still
making
money.
Wonderful music and money.
Well, that's Ben on the Run, right? But there's other songs that you never heard. This is Ben on the Run on other kind of style, right?
Yeah, because that was a later of Wings, right? But McCartney wrote it. But yeah, done in kind of a neat techno background style.
But anyway, there's other songs that I'll see if I can find them in a little bit. They are just completely different. Would that be possible? Do you think that do you believe in quantum physics and all that?
It's funny. There are things that fascinate me. You know, other worlds, those sorts of things, mm-hmm. right? Ghosts, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I say to my kids, you know, there's no ghosts, there's no monsters, and then world that exists at least for certain people or certain circumstances.
I'm going to go for a commercial break, and I'll come back.
Hi, this is Will Eimerich for Southern Star Automotive, proud sponsor of Rock Radio and More.
Just like a Hegoro Charlie.
Shut up, Charlie.
It's not your commercial, man.
Y yo soy Eduardo Fernández con Autos Estrella del Sur.
Isn't that the same thing?
Yes, autosestrelladelsur.com.
And southernstarautomotive.net
is the same thing. It's a Spanglish thing.
Southern Star Automotive has been in the automotive sales industry for over 20 years with great success by focusing on giving you the best customer experience.
Eso, 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 eso. En Autos Estrella del Sur te prometemos no presiones, no regateos, solo grandes ahorros en la compra del auto de tus sueños.
Yeah!
visita ya
AutosEstrellaDelSur.com
and SouthernStarAutomotive.net
y ven por el auto de tus sueños.
Low supply, high demand cars.
Estamos en Georgia.
Fresh inventory added daily.
Chécalo ya.
Con un trámite express y modelos de escoger. ¿Quieres autos seminuevos? Ven aquí, te los tenemos. Y confianza buscas tú. Autos Estrella del Sur.
Puede socializar bien y no puede hablar. Entonces dice, ay güey, aquí hay algo afín. Aquí tenemos algo común. Tú eres incomprendido, la gente te ve culera, la gente te daña, porque no te conoce. Entonces yo quiero darte la oportunidad de ver si de verdad eres tan malo. Porque ya ves que lo primero que ve la película es que, ¿no?, un ser salvaje, ¿no? Lo muerde, o sea, bien gacho a los que lo trataban mal. Entonces yo creo que ella da el primer paso de, antes de hacer un prejuicio, tratar de conocer a la criatura. Y no, yo creo que a él lo que le cautiva de ella es que ella no lo ve como un fenómeno, no lo ve como un monstruo, como una criatura horripilante. Y ahí es donde empieza la química. Después, ambos en su mundo, pues se dan cuenta, ¿no?, de que pueden coexistir. Yo digo que ella era plenamente feliz porque tiene una rutina, se hace su sandwichito, o sea, todo lo que ya ves en la película, e incluso sexualmente... Es una persona normalmente, una persona normal sola que se masturba en la bañera y que tiene un orgasmo y que es feliz. Tal vez no, si tú la analizas con respecto a otras mujeres que tiene una pareja, etcétera, pues vas a decir no es completa. Pero yo creo que sí era completa.
De la Sagrada Bitácora de Rock Radio and More.
Escucha de lunes a viernes. Rock, ¿qué onda?
Rock Radio and More. Estación Orgánica.
Llegó la hora chimbuenbuenchona, la hora cuchi cuchi. ¡Ja, ja! ¡Ay, es el momento de sentir el cuerpo, de sentirnos vivos! ¡Come on, Tom! ¡Tapping! Hey, what do you do to stay grounded, Tom?
Exercise helps. I know people have heard that before, but that's... That's certainly what I try to do. I've got young kids. I have twin girls, so that's a rat race, and being a lawyer can be a bit of a rat race, customer service and the like, and so I like to play a little golf. I play ice hockey, of all things, here in Atlanta.
Ice hockey?
Yeah.
You play ice hockey?
I play ice hockey. I grew up in the Northeast and grew up on skates, and so I play ice hockey. And
here in Atlanta?
Yeah, it's the second largest amateur ice hockey league in the country, believe it or not.
Where do you play?
Given where we are. So we play, for those that are here in town or know Atlanta, we play at the Cooler, we play at the Ice, which is up and coming, and then there's a new facility, fairly new, called Center Ice, which is over at 285 and Roswell Road.
What do you like about ice hockey?
Well, it's great for somebody with bad knees. I've had to give up some other sports, so... You know, when you skate, and you skate hard, right? So it's great exercise. A lot of it goes through your ankles more than your knees, so I'm able to do it. It's competitive, right? It's a competitive league. So for somebody who grew up playing sports, and I played baseball through college, so it's something I've done for a long time, to still be able to be competitive in something is really fun. It's just a great escape, right? Great exercise, great escape for a couple of hours once a week. The history of it, and being on skates and being enclosed with the boards, it I don't know, it makes you feel like you have to kind of fight your way out to get towards the goal or to get out of situation. So it's funny
nice
how that's evolved.
That they have on the sidelines like a couple masks or something in soccer. So, okay, let's hit it. Okay, boom, 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 that's it. Bye-bye. It will be nice. Well, I love that. Here, we talk about tapping ourselves, feeling our body, and probably repeating and saying things like that one. They're affirmations. I'm reading a book that is so nice. Estoy leyendo un libro que habla de la importancia de cuando haces afirmaciones, cuando dices cosas, asegúrate que no son mentiras. Make sure that you're not saying a lie. Mm-hmm. Because then your brain... A lot of people right now has been saying... Mucha gente está diciendo que tu cerebro no... No entiende si sí o si no, o sea, lo que, o sea, si tú dices una cosa, tu cerebro la entiende y así se va. Pero por otro lado, otras personas dicen, no, si tu parte, la parte de la que analiza el cerebro, la parte frontal, ve que tú dices, estoy bien, todo con madre, soy rico, pero no es cierto, tu cerebro, it will shut you down.
Yeah.
O sea, dice, no, esto es mentira y se acabó. Entonces lo que hay que hacer es una afirmación, preguntas a ti mismo de, how am I gonna do that? How am I gonna get better? How am I gonna get this? How am I gonna get that? And then your brain start finding the answers for you and connecting to the right sources. And that was a very interesting book that I'm reading that makes sense. But because we want to feel like, you can say, you know, God loves me, you know. Yeah, of course God loves you. You know, I'm so thankful for what I have. Yeah, of course, that's a good thing.
Yep.
Start feeling good about things. But anyway, thank you for sharing your grounding methods.
Of course.
Do you do meditation? Do you know anything about
meditation? No, it's funny. You know, my dad does meditation and even studied some. I want to say in Iowa, he'd gone out to college out there, and the transcendental meditation folks were out there. And that's something he's kind of done. As you say, to kind of even himself out on a daily basis. I've never really felt the need for that. I feel lucky. I don't battle like an addictive personality. I would think most of the people close to me would say he's a pretty even keel person. I don't feel like I'm repressing a whole lot. So, I feel like for me to kind of have some, and I'm lucky, I work by myself, right? I mean, it's customer service, but I'm not in an office anymore where I'm surrounded by office politics and all those things that can drain your energy.
Yes.
Each and every day, right? Which really gets frustrating. So I'm able to do my practice and provide my service, but I'm at least now removed from what I would call the daily grind of corporate and law firm politics, which has, you know, made my world a lot sunnier professionally. So, but I'm alone for a good chunk of the day. So I'm able very easily to take reflective moments and just get away from what I'm doing. And when I need to, just head down and do what I need to. So I feel, you know, mentally that I'm in a pretty good overall state. I hope. I'm knocking on wood now.
No, that's good. That's a very nice, good that you're aware of. Awareness is the most important thing that we can probably give thanks of.
Yeah, recognize the importance of that and do what you need to do, right? If you're struggling with those demons, right? If there are other things pulling you in the wrong direction, talk to people, talk to professionals if you need to, right?
Yes.
But be aware, and when you just need those little reflective, quiet moments, it's funny, I'm a very social person, so I kind of need, you know, the social aspect in groups, and I'm an only child, but I have really tight friends, and
you're the only child in your family?
Yep, but I've got a couple of best friends, some of the guys who I follow Springsteen around with it at times to bring back the music conversation, you know, who are like brothers, right? They're just best friends. They're not here in town, but we're in contact all the time, and we get together throughout the year to do different fun things. So that's super important for me, and knowing that that's there is great. And I've got a wonderful family, and I have this wonderful connection to both my parents are still alive, so that's great. And I have this wonderful connection to this whole family in Mexico, which is wonderful. So I feel very fulfilled.
There is a commercial on TV, I think T-Mobile, some kind of a TV commercial, and the guy is a kid, a white kid, dating a Latina girl,
yeah,
probably perhaps Mexican, and they're in a convertible car, but it's full of her family.
That's awesome. I was saying we could do an entire podcast about, you know, being a gringo who's now married to a Mexican or a Latino woman. That would be pretty fun.
What do you think is a good benefit marrying someone from another country? What would you, is that something, or is just because a person you like?
No, I think there's certainly that, right? You fall in love with who you fall in love with, but I also was supremely interested in her, right? Because of she wasn't from here, right? That was just fascinating to me. And as you learn about this person, you also learn about, you know, their interests, their language, their culture, right? Their story, which I think is just innately more interesting than if you happen to meet somebody next door to you in high school, right? At least for me, that was pretty fascinating. So getting, she was here studying on a, or teaching on a 2-year international visiting faculty program.
Okay.
And so we met here, dated for a while, although as part of this process, I learned you don't really date in Mexico like you do here in the States. So even that part was different.
Like, and what?
Well, it's just you tend to hang out as friends, and then if the woman decides that you're going to be together, she holds your hand, and then your whole life changes, right?
Yeah.
Whereas here, you got to date, you go to movies, and things kind of proceed. So that was really funny for me. I didn't realize when she wasn't holding my hand at the beginning, you know, that she was being very reserved about it. I just figured, hey, she only likes me as a friend. And then once she did hold my hand, I didn't realize that I would then be with that person the rest of my life and have a family together and all of that. So that was fascinating to
me.
You
have twins.
Twin girls, yeah.
Twin girls, that's it.
That's it, yep.
And you're closing the deal?
Yeah.
I mean, the...
Yeah, we're done.
Why?
We had kids pretty late, right?
Okay.
So it was a bit of a high-risk pregnancy. We were fortunate. We had twins in both families. We got the two at the same time, and it's been an absolute joy.
How often you guys go to Mexico?
We go, you know, it depends on the year. The girls, since they've been born, they've been down a couple times, and we're going to go down for Christmas. We often try to go down for the holidays if the prices are reasonable. So we're headed down for Christmas this year, which should be great.
You know, a good secret is go after Christmas.
Yeah,
cheaper. Just right on the 25th.
Right, so we're actually going down
there, right?
You'll appreciate this. So another cultural difference, right? At least. Versus the Latinos and at least what I grew up with here in the States, which was Christmas was the big day, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Christmas Eve, I know some people maybe opened a gift or went to church. Where I'm from is very heavily Catholic. So a lot of people went to midnight mass, that sort of thing. My birthday is actually on Christmas Day. So for me, the big celebration was on Christmas. And then obviously now Christmas Eve is big, right? Because it's so big in Mexico. So we're actually flying down on Christmas Eve day, and we'll get to Veracruz around 8 at night, and then we'll have the gauntlet of the next 8-9 hours of awesome food and drink and getting together with people and opening gifts and eventually crashing and then enjoying Christmas Day as well.
How about are you going to stay there for New Year's Eve?
No, we're actually going to fly back on New Year's Eve day. We'll get back, you know, before the turn of the year. We actually, for the last 4 or 5 years, we've had a New Year's Day party. So we kind of take in all those folks that have either didn't do much the night before or had a big night the night before, and we have a nice party at the house. So I hope all your listeners can join us for the big New Year's Day party.
Hey, do you cook, and does she cook anything?
Like, yeah, she cooks. Even better is when her mom comes to visit us, right?
Oh, and
she
cooks. Tamales?
She makes tamales, yeah, and
really?
She makes my favorite thing is pozole.
Oh,
she
nice.
Makes a wonderful pozole. So you know,
I love pozole, man.
So we have a funny story about we invited some friends over, some who are Mexican and kind of in these mixed marriages as well, right? Mexican with a Brit, Mexican with a Peruvian, Mexican with another American. So we had some folks over, and I came out in this shirt I'm wearing now, right, which is a Mexican national team jersey from a World Cup or two ago, and. And so my wife and my suegra, my mother-in-law, asked me, like, oh, is Mexico playing, right? Because it was during the summer. There were various tournaments going on. And I said, no, this is to celebrate that your mom made pozole.
The other day I called my friend Romy and I said, hey, Saturday morning. And I said, hey, let's go have pozole. And I said, you're hangover, right? Yes, I'm. You know, for when you're hangover.
Oh, it helps for that too,
that's
yeah.
Medicine.
Oh, that's
medicine.
Awesome.
You get it. Just boom, it's gone.
It's so good. It's just such a hearty dish, but it's really, really tasty.
Yeah, it has it's a good blend of fat that it will help you kind
yeah.
of.
Some vegetables, some tostadas.
Yeah,
some,
yeah.
Oh, it's wonderful.
Oh my God, it's delicious. Are you planning to, you know, do you want your kids to be lawyers?
No, I don't.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
I found it to be, on the whole, a challenging profession. I think a lot of that, and I should covet this with, I love being a professional. I loved what I learned in law school. The law is very interesting. That's no surprise to a lot of people. But the profession itself can be challenging. It can be really difficult just in terms of the expectations, right? Uh-huh. There's kind of been this buildup of, hey, if you're going to be a lawyer, you have to work crazy hours for years on end. And then, you know, the goal is to make partner. And that's a difficult way to live, right? So the study of laws is pretty fascinating, and it can be professionally, right? Doing what you're doing. So again, another reason why I'm glad I've gotten out of that big firm element, right? Kind of that crazy rat race of working, because back in the day you worked for 4 hours, or excuse me, for 4 years pretty hard, and you made partner, right? And everybody shared in the pie, right?
Yeah.
The profits. And now these days, these kids that come out of law school, they're expected to work as an associate for maybe 12 to 15 years, billing crazy amounts, right? Well over 2,000 billable hours a year, plus another 400 or 500 in non-billable commitments. I mean, these kids come out of school with crazy amounts of debt, which I had as well, unfortunately, right?
Yes.
Six figures in debt. And even if they get these wonderful coveted jobs at large firms, they have to work, figure a normal day for them is 9 in the morning till 9 or 10 at night, right? Monday through Friday, and then either half a day or most of the day Saturday, and at times round the clock, right? If there's big trials going on, or if there's big closings, you know, merger and acquisition work, these things go round the clock at times for, you know, for a few days or weeks or whatever it might be. It's really a gauntlet to run, right? It's which makes it hard to stay in shape, have other interests, right? Music, family, sports, whatever it might be. Forget sitting down reading a book for fun for years, right? Because what you're reading better be billable type reading. So it's in that way, it makes it a difficult profession for people who have other interests, right?
Yes. Well, I'm fascinated with all you have said. Say, I wish my mom knew you, because my mom made me. Yeah. I wanted to do music.
Yeah.
Right? I have to do music and law school.
Yeah.
But I have to quit music because I got so busy with my band, and I couldn't do band, music, music college, and law school.
As you know, because law school itself is challenging and very time-consuming, right? Every day there's, okay, here's the stuff to bring home. You're going to read all these different cases, which are oftentimes really, really fascinating, but that's at times meticulous because the way they're written are by other really wordy lawyers and judges and the like, mm-hmm. right? So, and there's a lot of, and details are important, as we know,
because
in the profession.
Because in the United States, the difference is we're different, you know, in our law system,
sure.
system of law or whatever. Here is more like case law, right?
It is very much. It's called, you know, it's based on the old British system.
Mm-hmm.
There's a system of called stare decisis, right? Which is just based on evidence that's happened prior. So when mm-hmm. you're making arguments for whatever your position might be, a key component of that is, What have the decisions been in similar cases in the past, right?
Yes.
Either mm-hmm. here in the state or at the federal level, depending on what sort of thing we're talking about. So
we call that jurisprudencia.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and but it's part of one of the elements. The most thing, important thing in Roman law is more like a law. I mean, what the law says.
What it says, right? Right. And obviously the case law gets into the interpretation of what people have decided that means, right?
What about the court system? When people has to decide on people, regular people has to decide on the future of any kind of case, crime or civil. What do you think?
Well,
I mean, because there's 12 guys, they have no idea that some of them might be very influential by Rush Limbaugh,
right?
Let's say like that, and then the guy takes away from someone that has the right to get a compensation or something, takes a right just because he was being brainwashed by an idiot.
I've kind of evolved on that. I thought going into law school, like, oh, the jury, you know, you see most of it on TV and movies, obviously, like, wow, that they really seem to put a lot of emphasis on that, and you see these wonderful, like 12 Angry Men, right, a famous movie about these jurists, you know, really battling and trying to figure out and being very thoughtful, right, with that process. The frustration now is, if you've ever been selected for to come in and potentially be a part of a jury, you know, people don't appreciate it really as a civic duty or as something interesting or fun anymore. It's just an inconvenience for them, right? So
yeah.
they're not as engaged or involved or, I think, appreciative of the importance of that system as they should be. And so if you don't have engaged people, then that makes that process not work well, right?
Yeah, because effective.
It's not as effective as it should be. So really, you then should, I think, fall back to either the judiciary, right, judges or a panel of judges or the other dispute resolution areas that can be used, whether it's arbitration or mediation. But it probably makes more sense to have, you know, engaged intellectual people, right, who are have been professionals in that area, right, so they can speak to the business side of it, right, because you really want to have decisions made, especially in commercial disputes, from people who understand the business side and can mesh that with the legal parameters, right? Okay, we understand that you're mad that he didn't pay, but understand that the reason they didn't pay is because they didn't think you provided the services or the products that they had contracted for. Mm-hmm. Let's reach some middle ground. And that's another frustrating thing to me about, at times, the civil and criminal system, is it doesn't allow a whole lot of in-between, right? It's either white or black, right? Either they need to pay you $9 million or they don't need to pay you anything, right?
Yes,
sometimes that can
yes.
be the result. And especially in the criminal arena, right? Either you murdered somebody and you go away for 20 years, or
yes.
no, you get off scot-free.
Yeah.
When those of us watching are like, well, he probably did it, but I'm not sure they completely proved it.
Yes.
You know, maybe we should put him away for 5 years.
Is not completely sure. Come on.
And not to mention the different standards.
That's so stupid. What happened with O.J. Simpson?
Yeah, it's a good example,
he
right?
He was guilty of this in the civil case.
Yeah, yeah. So for people who are confused by that, right? There's different standards, right? So reasonable doubt for the criminal case, which I think a lot of us would probably disagree with that result,
yes.
given the evidence. But amazing lawyering to get him off of that, and then years later, the family. Brought a civil suit, and civil is when you're just seeking compensation, not wanting to put anybody in jail, obviously. And that is a lesser standard. I think in California, if that's where they brought the suit, it was clear and convincing or a preponderance of the evidence, something that, right, which is just words. But if you think of something as being, you know, really difficult to prove and then something that's a lesser standard, not so difficult to prove, on the civil side, it was pretty easy for them to say, sure looks like he did it, and and we need to be compensated for the loss of our loved ones, right? So,
how stupid is that?
It's really, to me, and I think to most lay people, right, which is the term us lawyers like to use for people who aren't lawyers, it's an unnecessarily overly complicated system, right? Shouldn't it be simpler to make these decisions? Let's get the right people paneled to make those decisions, and then
yes.
let's make the standards easier, right,
yeah.
to make those decisions. And
yeah.
especially important things where we're talking about people's lives and major crimes and those sorts of things.
Well, we're going to go for a commercial break that I'm very late for it, but it was awesome to have this conversation. We're going to go in the second hour. Vamos a platicar un poco de lo que es los contratos comerciales o también de la protección de la propiedad intelectual, que es bastante importante. Ahorita hay mucha confusión con toda esta distribución de imágenes y de música y demás en todo lo que son las redes sociales. También hay personas que tienen ideas. Quiero hacerle varias preguntas y queremos protegerlas. Tampoco nos queremos meter en problemas en usando las ideas de otras personas o canciones, música y demás. Vamos a un corte comercial de nuestros amigos Del Campo en Grayson. Do you know those guys?
I know them well, yes, good friends.
Vamos a escuchar un comercial de sus amigos de Del Campo en Grayson y volvemos con un poco de música y la segunda hora de qué onda aquí en Rock Radio and More.
Los accidentes automovilísticos donde se involucran camiones de carga podrían tener consecuencias trágicas. Es importante que las víctimas